one of our co-producers who is wrangles in volunteers every year, and she does so much for Red Nation Celebration Institute. And without this kind of leadership in you know, with the backbone of our nonprofit, a lot of these events wouldn't happen. So I would like to bring up Jerry. Yay.
Okay, this is where we need technical support.
Just pop it out.
Just pop it out.
Just give a pull.
They're gonna
there you go. Okay.
Thank you all for coming today, tonight, and every one of you, appreciate it. That means it was meant for you to be here, and it was a beautiful film. I really appreciate that. In proper protocol, we are going to take time to pray, and I'm going to acknowledge the elder of the tribal people of this land, and that's the Gabrielino Tongvas. So I would like to introduce our elder, Julia Bagni, who will lead us in prayer. If you would please stand.
To give honor to my cousins, the Chumash, right here. So I'm from West Delhi, another side of the tracks. But I'm the elder of the tribe. I'm also the culture affairs officer and president of Kurumanga Springs right here in Santa Monica that has natural springs, in case you don't know that. So, always trying to protect them. So, at this time, I'm going to leave us in prayer. Este tahi honuka enoka te hovetaha yovaha voit te hovekaha. Dear Creator, we thank you for this evening and for all these wonderful people that came and for traveling mercies tonight. And I just thank you for each and every one and each family that's represented here tonight. Thank you for these wonderful women and for who they are. I have gifts for the panelists that my godchild is going to pass up.
Thank you very much, and much respect. We do this in protocol to each land that tribal nations belong to, and we'll enjoy the panel now. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Jerry. I'm going to bring up, I was at a ceremony December 21st. Max was there. And I heard these incredible young, beautiful women sing from the Chumash Nation. And I just fell in love with them. I was like, oh, please come and sing for us. So I would love to introduce you to them. And you're going to hear this, their beautiful voices and their blessing they have to offer.
Thank you. Haku Haku, so the song we're singing is a song by Juan Jose Olivos. We heard it from the Wax Cylinder recordings. And I just recently got permission from one of his granddaughters to be able to sing this song. And I feel so much better about singing it because I didn't know if he had any like living relatives. So yeah, so that is awesome. So it's a song about momentum and building that momentum. And we love to sing it. I sang it at Standing Rock because this movement is finally sparking like the average person and they're finally waking up. And so I want to continue that momentum. So, shoot, I forgot the key. Okay.
Hilua willele, lua willele.
By my oldest cousin of my generation, so she's like my auntie. And our language, our last fluent speaker died in 65, so we're bringing back the language. And so we're making our new songs. And so this is a song that honors our sisters, it honors the women. So we thought it was appropriate. Okay.
Hey, 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 sana kibnas. Hey, 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 sana kibnas. Hey, 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 sana kibnas. Yelene, kasho pantik, kasho pantik. Hey, hey.
Okay, we have, I mean, I was in tears, okay. Yes, I'm going to bring up a family member. I've known her since, maybe like 16. And I'm 60, well, I'll be 60 in October, but so it's a long time. I'd like to bring up my family, Ronnie Blakely. You may know her from Nashville. She's an Academy Award nominated actress and Bob Dylan's Rolling Thunder Review and just everything. Yeah, yeah. So when I was little, I used to hear her sing at the Palomino on her piano, and so this is a true blessing for us all. Because she's incredible.
Thank you, Jonelle.
Do you want to just hold it?
I think so.
Okay.
Thank you. It's such an honor to be here and be among you women. Thank you so much, Jody, Jonelle, for inviting me. And Max and I go back also. Max and I did a movie together once, a Western. What a day, what a great movie, what a great film that was. Educational in so many ways. And entertaining too, should be seen by everyone. We need to be educated. We don't have any way to learn these things. You know, we're like children reading a storybook. We just don't know. So that's the beauty and the magic and the brilliance. And your work, your personal work of your life is absolutely astonishing and inspiring. And I congratulate you on all that you've done. You know, there's only one water. Just one water. One ocean. One water. The headwaters of the Missouri are sacrosanct. I don't know the difference or the meaning or how to know boundaries of treaties compared to reservations, but I grew up in Oregon and Idaho, and I remember there being reservations. And I remember that they were called Indian reservations. They were called Native American reservations. And I still think that that's an honorable name, Indian. To me, it's very honorable. And yet I know it's not the preferred phrase now. And yet Russell Means and that group, the revolutionary arm of the Native Americans, is called Indian, AIM, the American Indian Movement. And we shouldn't forget the movement that was begun long ago and that carries forth to these times. And we must remember those who fought that good fight, and we have Winona who is carrying on in her way, in her area, but I think it's a universal matter because there is only one water. And the things that she is teaching us and the things that she is going on the line to say at the town halls and wherever else she is showing up, which is everywhere, you know, is that it isn't just a local thing. It's a worldwide thing. We only have one water, and I now want to pay tribute to my father, whose birthday was yesterday, who is a civil engineer in Caldwell, Idaho, and expanded his work to include Pendleton, Oregon. He counseled the Consolidated Tribes of the Umatilla for 35 years on their water rights, and help them preserve their water, which of course is the whole water table of the Columbia River, and that huge land and all that water, which has to remain pure because there's, you know, there's no other way. Once it's the genie is out of the bottle, it's over. So Dad used to go to Pendleton every week, and he had his own plane, and I remember once when he was getting older, and I remember the phrase was, he iced up over Pendleton, and Mom made him stop flying. But the tribes adored him, and he adored them. I have a song. I wish I could have written the songs that we just heard. So let me see if I can do one for you. I hear the village waiting, the mountain calls my name. Sweetwater, I'm the swimmer, I'm the one you've claimed. The totems now are falling, covered by soft rain. Great Spirit, hear my prayer, I'm coming home again. Take me home to the old ones with waiting in their eyes. Take me home to the mercy of misty morning skies.
Set my heart free to listen for the calling and the cries. Take me to the mountain of no thanks and no goodbyes. Many men have walked these hills, each has had his story. The winter snow has come and gone like a hero's glory. My land and my people, I'm a stranger and alone. I'm running up against the tide. Sweet water, take me home. Take me home to the old ones with waiting in their eyes. Take me home to the mercy of misty morning skies. Set my heart free to listen for the calling and the cries. Take me to the mountain of no thanks and no goodbyes. Take me home. Take me home. Sweet water, sweet water, sweet water, take me home.
Thank you so much.
We're going to start the panel.
We are going to start the panel. And Max is going to lead us.
Okay, I'm doing great. This has really been a wonderful day, and some really inspiring, wonderful films. And I see by looking out here, and I've been all day. A lot of you were here for this last, which was extraordinary, Carrie. Just a beautiful film. And that, you know, that mix of who we are. You know, someone, that question was asked, what is it? You know, it's sort of part documentary and part family story or something. But this is how we as humans relate to each other and find our common ground. You know, so I think my job really, rather than moderator of a panel, my job is just to acknowledge that we are in a circle here, even though there are more people on that side of the circle. You know, if the chairs weren't rooted down, we could get in a circle. So, you know, in the heart, let's get in a circle. And I'd like to just go across and to ask Shannon and Pearl, who some of you haven't met, to introduce yourselves and don't hold back. I mean, please. I'd like to go just to kind of get going across to also, even starting with you, Carrie, just say to each other and everyone here what you're looking to get out of this dialogue, this conversation we're going to have here, what you'd like to add, what, you know, just briefly to set the tone, to stake out that part in this conversation, rather than try to anticipate what the questions are to ask. You know, let's just get it going. So you could do that. Then Shannon and Pearl, if you would, you know, just let people know a little more of who you are and what you're doing together, and then we'll take it from there. Okay. And do you each have mics here?
I would just describe myself as a curious person, and so being here, I'm just very curious to meet the other filmmakers and to be able to find out more about what people are doing. And so it's just curiosity that brings me here, and respect and gratitude, basically.
Great. So that's your cue to go ahead and share with her.
My name is Shannon Kring, and Pearl and I are producing a documentary called End of the Line, The Women of Standing Rock. And I'm here because I think women need a louder voice. I think that women in the media need a louder voice. As I'm sure Carrie can tell you, when you go to a film festival, like, we find each other in the audience, right? There are like two of us who are women who actually direct. And it's actually estimates of between 2 and 7% of the industry is women. And as you can see by Carrie's beautiful work and many other women filmmakers, we tell a very multidimensional story. And it's not as if men don't, but somehow we look at things differently. And I think it reflects in the film. So I'm here for that reason.
Would you share with them, though, the range of films that you have been working on, and also just where you're from?
I'm from the Northwoods of Wisconsin, actually. I heard of Winona when I was quite young. I think I was probably about 16. My dad was a big fan of yours, still is. And I thought I mistook her for Winona Judd. I was like, what do you mean Winona Judd is doing activism, this country singer? And dad, like, didn't think that that was funny. She should. So she was a hero where I grew up. And for us, it wasn't the rice, it was the spearfishing. And there were literally bloody battles over spearfishing and then mining and pipeline and all of that. So I'm very familiar now. I know she's not a Judd. And it's funny. When I went out to Standing Rock, I only deal with indigenous films. I've never made anything other than one television series that was not based on indigenous people. My father actually said, you got to get Winona. I saw her, you know, on Amy Goodman, and she's at Standing Rock right now, and you need to talk to her, and you need to approach her with respect. As if I wouldn't, but you really need to ask how she feels about all of this. And he kept stressing the respect. And I think that's something that's largely missing from white society, quite frankly, especially among women. We have in the westernized world this kind of like this competition built in and cattiness and nastiness. And that's one of the things that really struck me at Standing Rock when I first arrived. First of all, I didn't know the women were the leaders. And I didn't know just how much they supported one another. And I'm really honored to have been welcomed into their lives and worlds. We've been following women in North and South Dakota now for about 7 months. And we actually were filming very late last night. And I really admire all the women who, like Winona, like Pearl, are doing amazing things, not just for their people, but for all people. And so my motivation is really, I'll be very honest, is to wake up people who look like me. Long story short, that's what I think my job is as a filmmaker.
I just want to express that Shannon is the director of a film that's in progress, but it also won at Red Nation Film Festival in November for The Pitch. We have a thing called Native Film Market, and Pearl is the producer of it, but it's called End of the Line, The Women of Standing Rock, and you didn't mention that, so I want to promote this film, and it's going to D.C. on March 14th.
It's not out yet, but please, if you're on social media, go on Facebook. That's where we're most active with our videos. We do post shorts on there. And we've got a Vimeo page, too, that's a bit harder to find. But Facebook, End of the Line Film. It's but if you just start typing in End of, now I think we come up first, which is pretty cool. So a lot of beautiful short segments on there that'll give you flavor for the story we're telling. We're telling a bigger story than the pipeline. That's kind of the backdrop, like with Carrie's film, where you're trying to tell a bigger story, but you have to have a hook, right? And so we're telling the story of all the atrocities that continue to be inflicted upon Native women, and not just in the U.S. I mean, it happens all over the world, but this is the story we're telling this time around.
Yate, hello, my relatives. It's good to be here. My name is Pearl Daniel Means. My Lakota name is Iowambia Enajue, and that loosely translates in English to bright light. I first of all want to offer a shout out to Santa Monica. I read earlier this week that your city council chose to divest out of Wells Fargo. So beautiful, beautiful. You know, this has been a long journey. My late husband, Russell Means, spent his entire adult life, over 40 years, to educate, bring awareness. He did everything within his power to have the United States government live up to its own laws. That's all he ever asked for. He was termed controversial. What's wrong with a society that labels the truth as controversial? Well, he made his transition October 22nd, 2012. And one of the last things he said to me was, "Hun, this is your time. It's the time of the female. We're in the female energy." What most people don't know about us as Indigenous peoples is that about 95% of us come from matrilineal social systems. That's not the flip side to patriarchy. It's not that the women control. It's that we recognize our differences. We embrace who we are as women, givers of life, our strength, our power. We don't compete with our men. We know who we are. We know what our values are. And our mandate in my culture, the Diné, the Spaniards termed us Navajo, is walk in beauty. Walk in beauty is to come into balance. Come into balance with everything. Two-leggeds, four-leggeds, water, winged, all those that live upon our grandmother, the earth. We know that we're in a time that our prophecy spoke to. It's a heightened energy. It's a refined energy. It's one of compassion, love, nurturing. And that's why I'm here today. I'm a mother. I'm a grandmother. I have a responsibility to speak. If we're going to survive, we have to come together, and we have to bring that pain to the table, and we have to be controversial, because only then can we heal and walk in beauty. Thank you.
I'd also like to say that Pearl is on our board of directors for Native Women in Film. And Russell was one of the first to be on our board of directors 22 years ago. And
I'm just really pleased to be here tonight. You know, want to support the work of the Native women in film out here. And, you know, really happy to see these films coming out. I did see these ladies at Standing Rock, and I'm looking forward to their film coming out, and I'm going to follow up and see what kind of the pieces are that we've released so far, and just happy to be here tonight with everyone. So nice to see Max.
You know, what occurs to me right now to take off from what's opened up here, used to talk with Vine Deloria about prophecy, because sometimes people have an idea of prophecy as the kind of a linear, specific prediction for the future. And Vine's understanding was that it really is about how things will unfold, the kind of conditions that are happening for things to unfold. And so maybe you could just share some, you know, take that as a takeoff point. But with all that is happening, with all of the kind of Trump business and that's showing up in other parts of the world, and at the same time with Standing Rock and the kinds of things that are happening. So in that sense of as prophecies unfolding in that way, just take that and run with it and pass the mic.
Standing Rock didn't just appear. It didn't just, all of a sudden, the word water protector just came up out of nowhere. It's really been a slow process over time, and I would say, you can't find an origin to it. I mean, I would say the birth of the American Indian Movement was a huge, big piece of the movement. And so I would say each decade we're part of that unfolding. We're all a part of that circle of unfolding. And so, I consider all the work that Winona did in Minnesota to be a part of the Standing Rock struggle, even though I didn't put Standing Rock in my film. And I think that we're all just growing because of one another. And so I would say that that's a beautiful thing that you said about the unfolding instead of being a linear prediction. So I would say it is that's how the movement goes.
My very first documentary was on the concept of the Mayas' belief that the world would end on December 21st, 2012. I was living in Honduras, where I've lived and worked for the past 10 years. And every time I'd come into the U.S., I would see on Discovery, History Channel, these documentaries about what the Maya believed was going to happen on this date. And I didn't know what the truth was, but I knew that they didn't believe what was being said. And I knew Nostradamus wasn't a part of it, because they always found a way to weave him and tidal waves. So I went on this exploration of what is this prophecy. And what I uncovered during that time, very easily, started going down another rabbit hole, was prophecies about women rising. And I found, with almost no effort, 29 prophecies that talked about the period between 2012 and 2020. And they were very similar, though the stories were different. Sometimes it was like the moon and the sun were going to converge, and then the moon was going to rise up out of the sun and the moon would be superior. Or sometimes it was based on analogies about crops or whatever, but the story was always the same. And so this idea of prophecy fascinates me, and quite frankly, I thought it was bull when I first started studying this. I thought the whole idea of 2012, even, that there would be this awakening, was bull. I thought, yeah, right, things are going to shift, and the major institutions are going to fall, the good old boys are never going to fall, and here we are, this short amount of time later. The good old boys are falling and the women are rising, and I look forward to seeing where it's all going.
You know, I've been reflecting a little bit about what the late legal scholar Felix Cohen said. He said, the American Indian is the miner's canary. And we are. We have a responsibility, a stewardship. We have a connection to our grandmother, the earth. That umbilical cord is still attached. Here we are at the last hour. We're looking at whether we'll survive as a species or not. We don't have a choice. And as American Indians in America, we are less than 1%. That's 99 point something percent genocide. We have nothing to lose, and we have a responsibility for the next seven generations. This position that we've taken at the Cannonball River was five women and one man. They needed somebody to put the help them put the teepee up. That's how it began. So we know that we need allies, and we know that we need to continue educating and getting our voices out. And I'm very, very proud to be here today and to sit next to my sisters. And they're doing amazing things with the media, with the activism, with the legal apparatus, with the strategy. We know we have to stay at least two steps ahead of the white man. We have to work that much harder. But we're very, very pleased to have so many allies. We welcome you. Because as women, our end game is to survive and to thrive.
Well, since Ronnie brought up the word educating, I know I expressed this in the earlier screenings today, but there are a lot of you that weren't here this afternoon. And so I'm going to express that it's been, since this is Native Women in Film, and we are all filmmakers. I'd like all of you to know one of the main reasons why we have Native Women in Film. Because it's been 24 years since you've seen a Native actress on episodic television. And for all of you that don't know what episodic television is, because I get some people asking me, what is that? It's on all the major networks. That's NBC, CBS, ABC, Fox. I'm not talking about cable, which is very rare, or they keep us, you know, in the past saying, me want more stew me. But I'm talking about the major networks. So when, in the 70s and the 80s, I used to work a lot in episodic television. That's how I made my living. My first love was acting. And I knew at 3 years old, I used to sit in front of the mirror saying, I'm gonna, you know, my acceptance speech for an Oscar. Yeah, and now this June, they made me a member of the Academy. So it's taken 40, you know, I don't know, I've been in the business 40 something years. But I want you all to know that you have not seen a Native woman's face
on television. So the genocide, the Holocaust, this whole bigger picture, and the energy that they've perpetuated in our psyche is to wipe our women and our children out. Now, they may not be aware of it in their everyday lives, these people that are making these decisions about this. Writing is out of the picture. But we haven't been on episodic television for 24 years. And that has to change. Because why? Because we have our murdered and missing women. It's like, oh, who cares about them? We'll just rape them and kill them. They're not anywhere in sight. Who cares about them? They're not going to be spoken about. Our youth committing suicide because they don't see themselves. They don't see their mommies. They don't see their daddies. So, because I've made been in this industry for so long, I've had some people call me that I respect a lot, that are very well known in this industry. And they say, Janelle, please start telling this. Start educating. What really has happened for me internally, I'm not working now anyway. So when Standing Rock happened, it ignited such a passion on so many levels. So deeply on so many levels of bringing so many people together on so many different levels. It has opened up this humongous dialogue that has never, ever, ever, ever happened before for humanity. So it's time for us, for our women to lead, for our allies, for our women of color, for our non-women of color, for all of us women to really stand firm and speak your truth. Stand up and do it, because I feel I waited too long to do it. So I'm letting you know, all you younger ones that are here, to stand up. Don't be afraid. Be deliberate and not afraid, because there's nothing to be afraid of. There's absolutely nothing to be afraid of. And everything to move forward in your womanness, in your livelihood. Even as elders, you know, if you've been afraid to speak your truth, now's the time to speak it and own it. And if we don't stand up, it's just going to perpetuate and perpetuate and perpetuate. So, you know, that's why this exists, because I've had enough. And I have a very precious daughter, and I raised a son, and he respects women, and I want my daughter to know to stand up. She does. And I want to thank all of you, you know, every single one of you, Winona, Pearl, Shannon, Carrie, have Ronnie and Sarah and
Leah.
That I love you, and you know, I will do everything I can to make sure your films are heard and seen, because it's important.
Okay, I'd like to, I think it would be good to hear some questions, you know, if you have, you know, come on around to this side of the circle. Yes, go ahead. Yes.
Yeah, I'm wondering about the relationship between activists and filmmakers. And I'm inspired by what you just said, Janelle. I'm wondering, as a local activist, knowing a lot of filmmakers being in L.A., what needs to be that relationship? Other than making a beautiful film, like Carrie did, what do you as a panel see as the relationship between Joe Schmo activists and filmmakers?
Don't be looking at me.
Well, we're all looking at each other.
Yeah. I don't know, you're the one who put up with the filmmaker, so it's,
yeah.
You know, I don't know, there certainly now we've seen a war start to happen in a sense on documentary filmmakers. And so I think that's one of the things that did come out of Standing Rock is that people have realized what a threat the camera is. Because it's so powerful, and that's what we've seen at Standing Rock with everybody with their phones, you know. And I think it kind of, in a way, it kind of goes back to Rodney King, now that we're here in L.A.
Okay.
And it's, you know, that camera does not lie. I mean, we edit, and so I'm not saying we don't bring our own vision to what we have seen, because we definitely do. But I think people understand the power of the camera, and so I would just say it's a really natural pairing.
When you're making films like these on the panel here, you have to have the activist gene in you, because not only are you up against things in your communities or wherever you're shooting, but nowadays with social media, there are attacks out there, and you just have to be pretty badass to stick it out and to keep doing it. But even more than filmmakers being activists, I kind of look at it as being a judge in a way, not judging the content of what we're bringing forward, but presenting, I guess it would be more of an attorney than presenting the evidence. And I look at for films that are social in nature, I look at the audience almost like the jury. I don't think it's my job to tell a person what to think or to try to make them emote at a certain time. I think that that's really formulaic, and I can always feel it when I'm watching someone's film, and I'm like, yeah, they want me to cry now, great. But I like to respect the audience and assume that people who are watching the types of films we all make are activists or support activism. And it's just our job to present the facts and let the viewer decide what to do with it. And hopefully we can inspire some people to stand up and become activists in their own right.
What fears did you guys encounter in making your films and in the activist movement that you've participated in, and then how did you overcome those fears? What were your main practices? How did you overcome the fear?
Did you guys hear what she said?
How did she overcome the fear?
She asked what fears did they have to overcome, and
how did they do it?
And how did you do that?
Mine was being white. I'll just be very frank about that. I knew when I showed up at Standing Rock that there would be judgment, like, who the hell are you to tell this story? And I had to question myself, like, can I do the story justice? Can I? For me, it was my own fear of my own stuff. And then, of course, when I posted the very first thing on Facebook, of course, what came is people, you know, who are you to make this? Let us tell our own stories. Which I completely understand. And I just thought, you know, this is the kind of crap that Native people, Indigenous people the world over have to put up with, those attacks, questioning. And I thought, ooh, this is really important for me to feel this. It's important for me to feel like the minority, for me to show up and feel like I'm on the defensive. And it immediately went away. And you know, we face threats. Today when I landed, I flew in from DC this morning, and when I landed there were 288 new comments, and of those comments, 14 of them were threats on our Facebook page. So that doesn't have to do with what I look like or that it's women. These are threats from people dealing with the pipeline specifically, and say really heinous, really nasty things, really, really like horrific things. And sometimes because we're such a small group, we don't catch it right away. And then you'll see 70, 80 comments to someone calling a woman the C word. And there was this, we did a video on the first baby born at Standing Rock. That we had to go in and ask that YouTube would moderate the comments because we weren't able to remove them ourselves. And it was all about like, who's the father? She doesn't know who the father is. I mean, just crazy. And it snowballed, and then people threatening, and we should kill all you bitches, and things like that. And it was interesting that that was on YouTube, where we have a much smaller following, but Vimeo was all this support and love. And so, as always, it's the trolls, the opposition. But today, it's a little bit easier for people to express things like that without repercussions. So, yeah, that's my fear.
What do you do to feel safe, though? Like, how do you, what do you, like...
I just don't care. I have this thing, and that's what serves me well. It has served me very poorly in the rest of my life. I have done dumb things. I've paid the price for doing many dumb things. But I look at these women, and I look at these activists. I look at that they have their life on the line, and I don't even think. Like a week and a half ago, they were shooting people with cameras, rubber bullets, if we got too close with our cameras. I actually practically had to be held back because I was like, oh, let those effers, you know, shoot me. And it just fuels me and feeds me. So I don't have that sort of fear. My fear is always, can I do the story justice? Because I take it very seriously. Again, I keep hitting this point, but as a woman who looks like people who have oppressed and killed the people that I'm welcomed into their homes and their sacred ceremonies, I take that very seriously, and I just want to do a good job, so.
Well, more power to you.
How about Winona? Have you experienced it?
You know, I'm a little bit like you. I mean, you look out there and you know, I mean, sometimes I get nervous. I'm like, well, looks like we're up to bat. You know, you just got to go out there. And, you know, you're looking around and saying, let's go. And, you know, so that's what you do. And because someone's got to take responsibility, and a lot of us have to take responsibility. And there needs to be more people that don't sit on the sidelines or sit on the Facebook page. They need to get out there. Because that's what we need, is a lot more numbers, and you know, and just to continue being courageous. And then also, like, I mean, you heard me say it more than one time. I mean, you know, I look at what their projects are. Not only are they dumb and dangerous, but they're just like stupid wastes of money, you know. And so you need to just keep after them on that, because they're going to spend billions of dollars on infrastructure for oil companies. That's what they want to do, and that will not help the people in Flint. They will not get water out of it. You know, and what was it, 131 or 151 communities in Canada that they have boiled water advisories for in Michelle's film today? 131, you know, First Nations communities in Canada that don't have boiled water advisories for them. So, like, where's their justice? Where's their infrastructure? They need some pipes, you know, but we want pipes for people, not for oil companies. And you know, I'd say you guys get problems in infrastructure here in California, too. You know, so I feel like we need to keep talking about this. So this isn't just, you know, this is like common sense. How, what are you going to do 50 years from now? You're going to have 50 years more old pipelines that are busted up. You know what I'm saying? So how about like we start doing some,
care.
Yeah, some let's do some smart stuff. So, you know, I just keep after him. And, you know, in the case of Enbridge, it became really expensive. I understood we cost him $600 million. I felt really bad about that. Not really. You know, but this is money to them. This is money. And the longer you fight them, the more expensive their projects are. And I've seen projects go down. And, you know, that's what should happen. But I think that this is all about justice. And it's not just about pipelines. It's about justice. And what do we want our country to look like? And who's, you know, who's going to be here? And so who's going to stand up for that? We all got to stand up for that. Makes perfect sense to me.
I have a question for you about fear. Because you're known as such a strong... person as you are, were you nervous about showing your vulnerabilities, showing your personal life Did she take convincing? Were you afraid of that?
Well, that yoga scene was a little embarrassing. I was like, it is obvious I can't do yoga. Like, I'm really trying, Mom. I'm really trying. And it's funny because it's a repeat every time I go see her. I was like, oh, gosh, I have not been to yoga class again. You know, so I'm trying. But, you know, I mean, we're all human. And, you know, I'm really proud of my kids and my family, and we're all, like, you know, I mean, I feel like everybody can see there I'm pretty much a mom. I'm telling them what to eat, and, like, you know. And so I feel like, you know, I wasn't really nervous about it. I mean, I know that I just pray really hard. You know, pray really hard, and I got a lot of people got my back. You know, and I think that's the way it is in our community, and, you know, and then just keep going on it. And, you know, because I a couple weeks ago, and Carrie was with me today, I was talking to the chief of police at Bemidji, right? Because Enbridge had a meeting on their new pipeline, the 760,000 barrel a day tar sands pipeline headed our way. And they had a little informational meeting in the town of Bemidji, and it wasn't really set up for an informational meeting. It was a landowners meeting, and I thought they'd have like 20 white people at it, and it was like 150 people. And 120 of them were Indians. And they were not set up. They didn't have a place for anybody to sit. They had nothing, you know, and so it wasn't set up. And so there was elders leaning against the wall. This one lady is, you know, Margaret Troyer, she's leaning against the wall with her oxygen tank. And I was like, wow, that's really good, Enbridge. You know what I'm saying? It's like they totally did not want us in there. And so I walk in this meeting, and this one young blood, he's like, you know, he's a rapper up there, and he's like, hey, Winona, you know the most about this pipeline. Would you just, like, ask a couple questions for us? Because we really want to know things, you know? So I was like, okay. So I get there, and like the Enbridge guys are up against the wall, and I says, so I use my big girl voice, you know, this one here, my mom voice. I was like, so guys, hey, Enbridge guys. I said, you know, Standing Rock, that place out there, you know, you invested a third of the money in that pipeline. And we all saw that. And a lot of people in this room were out of Standing Rock. And some of these people took rubber bullets. And we took a lot of bullets, and we saw a lot of tanks, and we feel that you're responsible for a third of the bullets. You're responsible for a third of the tanks and a third of the injuries. And now you want to come into us and talk to us. And so we'd like you to account and explain your behavior out there. You know, explain what you're doing and what you're going to tell us. You're going to bring tanks here. That's what I said to him, right? At which point, the Enbridge people are like this. On the side. And this cop comes right for me, and they threaten me with arrest. And I was like, you know, on what grounds? I said, we'd like an answer to the question. I mean, you saw me with the PUC, and I was like, we want to answer the question. I've been asking this for like 2 years, like, answer the question. You know, I was like, would you answer the question? And pretty soon everybody's like, answer the question. And then what happened is that the cops come after me, and they're like, you know, lady, you're going to have to go. And I was like, you know, we just want the question answered, you know. And this one big, she was in the movie, a couple of those ladies were in the movie, one of them grabs me on each side and says, she's not going nowhere. You know, and that's what it's like. It's like two big Indian chicks grab me, and we're like, we're not going nowhere. You know, and that's the way it was. And then pretty soon everybody in the room is like, you know, I mean, it's, you know, then Enbridge slinks out the back. And, you know, but today I call the cops. I had a call with them because the guy who was directing it didn't have a badge on. And I said, and when we asked him, when Don asked him, Don's a former police commissioner, he said, what's your badge number and who are you? The guy wouldn't tell him. I said, you got to do that. And so I like was lecturing the police chief, and he's, you know, apologized for that to me. You know, I said, you know, I know who he is now because I asked, but, you know, your officers can't arrest us. And so we have a big hearing on the 7th of March up there with Enbridge and the State Departments, because they're looking at issuing, that's the first permit for the cross-border pipeline. And they have a hearing. And I said, well, I'm going to be up there, you know, but I'm going to be there, and I expect that you guys be respectful, and we'll be respectful. I said, we're going to have jingle dress dance, and I'm going to testify. That's what I'm going to do. And so, you know, he's like, oh, we don't want Standing Rock. I said, no, you don't. You know, you don't want that. You don't want that. There's a lot of, you know, they're nervous. Everybody's nervous about it, you know, in this territory. And, you know, so just people got their back, and we'll work on it, you know, together. But just we stick together. Stick together on it. So.
I would just say that in general, filmmaking is terrifying. Basically, it's just so darn hard. And I don't think anybody can ever really understand when you see 10 seconds on the screen, how many hours I put into that 10 seconds. And so the editing, the shooting, everything. It's just, it's terrifying. And then you want to be respectful, and then you know, you also don't want to put people on the screen who don't want to be on the screen, and then when you have people who are on the screen who you know really don't want to be on the screen, like all those Enbridge people and the PUC people, yeah, I'm wondering what they're going to do when they see my film. Yeah, I'm wondering what Jamie's going to say when she sees it. She's not going to want to see it. But, you know, yeah, I'm nervous to be respectful of the people who I respect, and then I'm nervous of the wrath of the people who I don't respect. But mostly, you know, you just try and do a really, really good job. But it's terrifying. The whole thing is just really, really hard, I would say. And wonderful, because at the end, you know, you're writing history. And so I feel like a historian.
And you're making a difference.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ronnie.
So we're going to do two burning desire questions, because it's after 10:30.
Okay, so I just had a question for Wainona. You had a preempted dream that about the Standing Rock, the pipeline and everything. I was wondering, do you have these dreams like your entire life, or is this something that happened during in my opinion, the Mayan calendar ending was a human consciousness shift. Was it stronger for you then, these messages, or?
You know, I probably had different dreams during my life, but you know, I know I had this dream about riding our horses against the current of the oil, and I had a recurring dream. And I was trying to understand it, and then, you know, everybody kind of laugh at me and my family. I mean, you see my kids, how much fun they make of me, you know? And so then I went out and bought a horse trailer, and they're like, you don't even have a truck to haul the horse trailer. So I leave it out there, and I got it on Craigslist. I just love that Craigslist, right? And so then they're like, Mom, and then I was like, I'll get a truck. You know, and then, you know, I've ridden my horses, but they're like, you never rode like 200, 300 miles. Like, I'm going to ride 200, 300 miles, and just wait. You know, and so, you know, it makes you, I think every year you should, I mean, all the time you should try to be a bigger person.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, don't just slide. You know, and so sometimes, like, I've done a lot of things, and, you know, obviously I had a horse sit on me. That was not my plan. But, you know, I'm good now, and I learned, and then I had this motto, which was, a couple years ago, my motto was, don't get bucked. You know, which is, it's generally a good philosophy, don't get bucked. But then sometimes you also got to know when to bail, which is what I didn't know when I had horses. Right. So those are like, you know, that's like horse riding lessons. So a horse teaches you too. You know, stay right on it. You know, but then also, like, you know, if you're going to, you know, he's going to flip over and you should probably bail. You know, so keep that in mind. You know, you learn from your animals, you learn from your corn, you know. I mean, you know, life gives you a lot of ways to learn, so.
Your dreams.
Yeah, and your dreams.
You get the last question.
Okay, I don't know if this is a question. I just wanted to say that I've been following you, Wainona, for a long time and had never actually met you face-to-face, but had the pleasure and the honor of publishing some of your stuff. And oftentimes the work that we do, we're information activists, and we publish, and I get so doggone depressed. And that, you said a line in the film, don't get depressed, make a dress. Mm-hmm. So I don't get depressed, I make a mess. But I wanted to thank Carrie for showing Wainona and the entire community there in the way that you did, because it was absolutely inspirational for people like me who are doing similar kinds of work. And really, it's so hard. And you kind of want to give up sometimes. Mm-hmm. And that film, I think, is magnificent and hugely inspirational for the activist community.
Oh, thank you so much. And I think you could say the same thing about some of the film we saw earlier today.
Absolutely.
People speaking to camera and speaking from the heart, and such intelligence and such inspiration. Let's all just thank these women and all the others they represent.